My name is Sally Jones and I'm from a Deloitte Tax Policy and Public Policy Department based in London. I have four speakers with me today. I have Mark Fitzpatrick, who's our Managing Partner for Clients and Markets, Ian Stewart, our Chief Economist, Rick Cudworth, who leads for us on contingency planning, those three are all based in London, and Christiane Cunningham, who's based in our Deloitte Brussels Policy Unit. As you may guess from their CVs, all of them have extensive professional experience. Before we begin, just let me take a moment of your time on admin. If you press the F11 button on your keyboard, then you can view the slide console in full screen, and that means you can access all of the areas. But pressing F11 again will take you back to the smaller view if you prefer. Alternatively, you can maximize the slides by using the slide view box and for the full screen, and again, pressing the same button will take you back. You can ask us content-related questions at any time by entering your question in the box to the left of the slide view box and pressing submit. Should you need technical support, then use the question mark icon at the bottom of your screen. Finally, if you do accidentally minimize the slide view, it's not hard to do, you can access it again via the icons at the bottom of your screen. So without further ado, I'm going to hand you over to Mark Fitzpatrick to kick us off.
Good morning, everyone. As you are all aware, the UK has voted to leave the European Union. Over the last few months, we have thought long and hard about the potential implications for you of this so-called Brexit. We have also worked with many of you towards preparing a response to this event. In this period of elevated uncertainty and volatility, I would like to emphasize that we continue to stand by you, our clients, to help you monitor and navigate this fluid economic and political environment. To that end, we have organized today's webinar, the first in a series of events, in which we will share our evolving thoughts and analysis of the business impact of Brexit over the next few months. So on our agenda, we have four key areas to cover. Firstly, prospects for the UK and European economies and for financial markets. Secondly, the future of the EU and Britain's place in Europe. Thirdly, the trade and tax implications of the UK's changing relationship with the EU. And finally, how businesses and organisations should respond to the changing environment. So without any further ado, let me hand over to Ian Stewart, who will lead through the first element, and we'll be able to take questions at the end. Thank you.
Thanks, Mark. Good morning, everyone. I thought it would be useful just to step back from this result and ask, how does it compare with expectations? And who got the result right? So up on the screen in front of you, hopefully you can see the outcome of the referendum, and you can see just how wrong the spread betting odds were. So the market last night was assuming that it was going to be about a 55% of the vote for Remain. And actually how the very last opinion poll, which showed a 10 percentage point lead for Remain, was also wrong. The intriguing thing is that the trend in the opinion polls, which I think we've all paid far too little attention, was bang on, or very, very close to the actual result. So it showed a strong lead for Remain. So I guess this has been a big shock for the bookies. This time yesterday, they were pricing something like an 86% chance of Remain. Just in terms of thinking about this event, there's clearly no precedent at all, but it has, I think, some similarities on a much larger scale with decimalization in the 1970s and Y2K, which were huge logistical and complex exercises in change and preparation. And in terms of the shock, I think it bears something in common with the UK's ignominious exit from the ERM in 1992 and the Lehman's crash in 2008. So a major shock with long effects, many of which will only emerge over time. If we think about the immediate effects on the next slide, so what are the immediate effects? Turning to the next slide, you can see that clearly the uncertainty has expressed itself most forcibly in liquid assets, so equities and sterling. we survey corporates regularly, and what we tend to find is that big moves down in equities are associated with weaker business confidence, slower capex, a softening of M&A. So I think we are at a stage in the cycle where corporates are going to be likely to be focused on cash and cost control. Now, the Treasury a couple of weeks ago forecast that in the event of the UK leaving the European Union, GDP growth would be flat in the next 2 years. On average, economists are a bit more optimistic. They're assuming growth, which normally runs around about 2% a year, will slow to 1.4% this year, slowing to 0.7% next year. So they're forecasting a sharp slowdown for next year, but not a recession. In the medium term, I think much hinges on the speed and the success of negotiations. And in the long term, I think the key question is the extent to which the UK is able to exploit freedoms outside the European Union and secure a favourable trading arrangement. Now, if we look at the state of markets overnight and look at the next slide, you can see that the FTSE, FT100, is down 4.7%. Actually, it's less than the fall in the German equity market, the DAX, and you've seen a sharp decline in the dollar. Sterling against the dollar as well. Now remember that both equities and sterling were rallying strongly into the referendum. So yesterday, the day before, were very strong days for sterling and for equities as the market started to price in an assumption that it was going to be a Remain vote. So if you look at the damage in the UK equity market, in the FTSE at the moment, it's down about 4.7% actually, which is similar to the worst day in the last year. There's a big caveat around this number. Most of the damage is concentrated in banks and building stocks. We've seen much bigger falls there. And if you look at measures of the equity market which strip out more international global companies, so like the FTSE 250 index, that's showing much bigger declines, a decline of about 8%. If we look at the next slide, I guess we can make some guesses as to what effect this might have on the corporate sector. In the last couple of months, we've already seen quite a pronounced weakening in corporate risk appetite, a rise in perceptions of uncertainties as chief financial officers whom we survey worry about the risk of a UK exit from Europe. And today's result, I think, makes it highly likely that with a fall in equity markets, we're going to see a further softening of risk appetite and, of course, a rise in perceptions of uncertainty. But let's just have a look at the next slide at what this might mean for GDP growth. Now, there have been lots of forecasts produced in the last couple of months looking at what Brexit might do to economic activity. And if we look at the next slide, please, what we can see is that on average, economists expect a very marked slowdown in growth next year. They don't expect a recession. So just look at this. I'm sorry, could you go back one slide, please? We seem to have jumped ahead. Economists aren't expecting the kind of downturn that followed Lehman's exit. They're expecting something which is a bit worse than the double-dip downturn of 2011-12 at the time of the euro crisis. So expecting growth next year of about 0.7%. They were previously expecting growth of about 2%. But look, in the long term, expectations at the moment, this is before the referendum, but the expectations in the long term is that growth in the UK is unchanged at around about 2%. Okay, if we go to the next slide, please.
Thank you. This is the first of our two polls, which is your opportunity to give us your views. And our question is that in the medium term, say the next 3 years, how do you think that your organisation will perform compared to the position has the UK voted to remain? So please do select one of those answers only. And while you're giving it some thought, Ian, we've asked people for their views about medium-term economic impact. What do you think the long-term economic impact is going to be?
Well, I think that's the thing that people are going to have to argue about over the next few months. And I think they're going to make up their minds on the basis of the success of UK negotiations with the European Union, which we have learned recently are not going to start until after October when the Prime Minister steps down, the new successor comes in and triggers Article 50. So the real question is, what sort of a deal do we get out of the European Union? And what is the government's vision of the long-term economic future of the UK?
So if you were a gambling man, Ian, and I was buying you gin off the back of it, what do you think the outcome would be?
Well, I think clearly, you know, we're going to be hearing an awful lot about uncertainty in the next few months. But I think in the long term, and we'll talk about this a bit, the fundamentals for the UK are quite good. And I think that is consistent with the idea that in the long term, UK growth is going to return to the kind of 2% mark, which most economists expect at the moment.
Well, our poll results are now in, so let's see what you, our audience, have to say. It's going to come up on your screen very shortly. And unsurprisingly, what we're seeing is that very few of you think that profits are going to be much up, but there's a decent proportion of you think that profits are going to be either slightly lower or, in fact, significantly lower, with more than 5% down on previous forecasts. Ian, does that come as a surprise to you?
I think that's what I would expect. I mean, it's interesting that only 16% expect profits to decline more than 5%, and I guess it's what 25% or so who assume negligible or sort of modest change in profits. So I think the bulk of our respondents, who are getting on for 40%, are expecting a slightly lower profits over the next 3 years.
Thank you very much, Ian. If you'd care to continue with your presentation.
Yeah, thank you. Well, I understandably, we are all going to be hugely focused on political news and market movements over the next days and weeks. And I just want to sort of stand back and ask a more fundamental question about where does the UK, what's the UK economy look like in comparison with other economies around the world? And I think this is important because it goes to the heart of Sally's question about what is the long-term future for the UK. And there are three separate measures of competitiveness compiled by international organisations which seek to measure in different ways the competitiveness of a host of economies across the world. What stands out from them, and you can see the numbers in front of you, is that the UK ranks pretty highly. It's towards the top end, and it's certainly up there with countries like Sweden or the Netherlands. It's seen internationally as being a highly competitive economy. I think, although we're going to be very focused on news flow, that we need to keep in our minds, in the back of our minds, the fact that actually the fundamentals, the sort of institutional fundamentals in particular for the UK, are really quite favourable. Okay, can we move to the next slide, please? So I suppose the immediate focus today is on UK politics and policy. So the question of who's in charge, and of course that has now been answered by the Prime Minister saying that he will be stepping down, triggering a leadership election in October. The current favourites to succeed the Prime Minister, these are the latest bookies odds. Boris Johnson is strongly ahead. And of course, interestingly, George Osborne doesn't figure at all. Now, the government and the authorities, typically when they're faced with a major shock to the economy, they don't sit on their hands and do nothing. They look for ways of trying to stimulate the economy. I think one way of trying to build confidence would be signalling that the government is pursuing a free market, open for business approach. So there's a question about signalling where they want negotiations to go. They could have an emergency budget. They could cut taxes if they wanted to. They could suspend the fiscal and inflation targets. The Bank of England Mark Carney signaled today they stood ready to provide liquidity to the banking sector. They could go further. They could undertake further quantitative easing. And the European Central Bank could also pile in with more quantitative easing. So I would expect some sort of policy response to emerge over coming days. There's a huge bureaucratic task in terms of setting up the machinery for negotiating this process. It will absorb the energies of a civil service, which, as we see it, say here, is smaller than in 75 years. And of course, there are very big questions about Scotland and Northern Ireland. If we move to the next slide, just thinking about the mechanics. Now, there's no precedent or template for a major country to leave the European Union. Article 50 of the Lisbon Treaty starts the two-year negotiation period. The Prime Minister has said that it will be for his successor in October or November to decide when to start the two-year negotiation period. It's worth noting that the Leave campaign said the week before last that they would like to legislate fairly early on to opt out of the European Court of Justice, to put controls on EU migration, and to repeal the European Communities Act 1972, which took us into the EU. Now, this is important because remember that 71% of MPs favoured Remain. So the bulk of MPs favoured Remain, even though by a narrow margin the country favours Leave. That could have an effect on the government's ability to get legislation. Leave want to get a deal by May 2020. And such a deal would need a qualified majority of member states in Europe to agree to it. Remember, this two-year negotiating period can be extended by unanimous agreement. And during this period, all existing EU legislation is in place. We in the UK have no vote on EU matters. The big question, and let's look at the next slide, I think, is whether this is going to be a fractious or a harmonious divorce. And this will have a big effect on the economic consequences. The arguments for a harmonious divorce are that we matter a lot to Europe and Europe matters to us. We are Europe's largest trading partner. Uncertainty and risk damages all. The European Union has a history of pragmatism. They let countries into the euro even though they didn't strictly meet the rules. And the EU has other concerns, so maybe he wants to get Brexit sorted out quickly. But there's an argument for fractious, and we've put some of them on the right-hand side. I think the key point is that Europe may want to send a signal to other countries that getting out of the EU is difficult and time-consuming, and that Britain's example will quell secessionist sentiment everywhere. Could you look at the next slide, please? Now, there is no roadmap for where we are heading. There are many different alternatives to EU membership, and we've shown some of them on the slide in front of you. I think the key point about this slide is that through the campaign, the Leave campaign has increasingly gravitated to a more distant formal economic relationship with the European Union, so favouring something like an MFN, most favoured nation status relationship, or a duty-free relationship, in which actually the UK no longer has access to the single market, but does control the free movement of people. So this will be a huge issue, the extent to which the referendum result is seen as a vote against free movement. If it is, I think it'll be difficult to retain full current access to the single market. Let's look at the next slide, please. Now, this vote in the UK is clearly a massive political blow for the European Union, and you can observe it in the financial markets, where actually the German and French equity markets have fallen more today than the FTSE 100 in the UK. So this is a crisis for Europe, and it comes on top of the migration and a currency crisis, which are continuing, and it takes place at a time when Europe is starting to recover. There is a nascent recovery in Europe. countries closest to the UK, so particularly Ireland, Netherlands, Norway, Switzerland, are going to be most exposed. Eurosceptic parties in Europe will be emboldened to pressure for referendums, and there are big there are big general elections coming up in Europe in the next year. Let's just look at some of those challenges on the next slide, please. So you can see here are the four big challenges for Europe, topped by Brexit. And Europe, we think, has three approaches. It steps up integration, it tries to bind itself together. It goes for a multi-speed Europe in which different countries and groups of countries proceed at different speeds. Or muddle through, you get a combination of approaches. But this is a big turning point for Europe, make no mistake. And this is not just about what happens in the UK, far from it. Let's just look at the next slide to put what's going on in Europe in some sort of context. I think what we need to remember is that in the 90s and 2000s, Europe went through a period of very strong growth, growth of 2.5% a year, and rapid integration, the single market, Schengen, single currency, EU enlargement. In the last 7-8 years, we've had a much slower growth, and we've had a loss of political momentum too. And so this vote today comes at a very difficult time, clearly, in the history of Europe. Now let's look at the next slide. I think what's important is that if you look at public opinion in Europe itself, actually skepticism about the European Union has risen. This isn't just a British phenomenon. So 47% of EU voters outside the UK take an unfavorable view of the European Union. That's a rise from the figures that prevailed in previous years. Most voters clearly see UK leaving as a bad thing. And interestingly, there doesn't seem to be a strong demand for the European Union to take more power. We surveyed in Germany German CFOs 2 weeks ago, and 66% of CFOs said that if there was a UK vote to leave, they thought there would be further referendums on membership of the EU in other European countries. Next slide, please. Now, the backdrop for Europe is that populist and secessionist parties of left and right are on the rise. And this slide just illustrates that. The Austrian Freedom Party almost won the presidency in Austria. But similarly in France, Italy, the Netherlands, Spain and Germany, there are sizable rising political parties who are much more skeptical about the European Union. And this matters because if we look at the next slide, there are major elections taking place in Europe over the next year. In Spain over the weekend, then in the Netherlands, France and Germany through the course of next year. So actually Angela Merkel and President Hollande will be contesting their position. These negotiations with the UK will take place against the backdrop of major political debates in these economies. Next slide, please. Britain leaving the European Union changes the character of the European Union. You see this on the next slide, produced by Open Europe, a very good think tank looking at this area. Well, it makes the point that actually without the EU, the balance of power in Europe shifts to a less free trade, more market skeptic position. So it has a material change in terms of the orientation of Europe. So finally, for my section, if we could go to the next slide, please, just to sum up. This clearly is a major shock to UK growth, certainly in the short term. That effect should diminish over time. It'll be a function of the speed and effectiveness of the negotiations, the strength of the policy response at home, and of course, also a function of all the other things which drive growth, including the state of the global economy. But we are in a slow growth world where geopolitical risk is elevated, so this clearly adds to the challenges facing the UK. We do have great strengths, and I think we need to keep those in mind. Institutional high level of resilience and competitiveness, but this is an epic political administrative challenge for us and for Europe. European rules will run for the next 2 years once the negotiations start. And it's worth remembering that Leave during the campaign said they wanted to end free movement of people. That does imply economically a more distant relationship with Europe than, say, Norway or Switzerland have. And there's no doubt that Brexit does add to the crisis of institutions, growth and public support in the EU itself. Lots of questions. So when, you know, who leads the UK and how? What does the UK want in these negotiations? That will be a function of who leads. Is this going to be a fractious or harmonious divorce? Big elections coming in Europe next year. And I think underlying this is a fundamental question about the direction of Europe. Is Europe going to be a multi-speed Europe with different coalitions and groups of countries moving at different speeds? Or will it aim to move as one and move to ever closer union, more integrated Europe? With that, I'll hand over to my colleague, Rick Cudworth, go through the implications for businesses and corporates.
And in fact, you may think that Rick has got a very feminine voice, but in fact it's our second poll question, your second and final chance to give your views. So this time our question is, what's the most pressing action required of your organisation in the immediate term, say over the next month? Again, please select just one of those answers. And while you're giving that some thought, Rick, you've spent a lot of time talking to businesses over the past 6 months. In your professional experience, how ready have companies been for a Leave vote?
Sally, yes, this is Rick this time. I think it's been quite variable. From the evidence we have, if I make some generalities, I think it's fair to say financial services institutions in particular have been the most prepared. Whilst many corporates, I would say, have taken more of a wait-and-see approach. I know that's a generalisation, but I think that's a trend overall that we've certainly seen. And I think, you know, and I will touch on it when I go through the slides, whether you've already prepared or whether you're just about to start to, I think clearly now is the time to act. If you have already started to already prepared, then it's going to be about broadening and deepening that thinking. If you haven't started, then it's about getting started.
Thank you very much, Rick. Now, are our answers ready? I believe that they are. Hope you will see them. Yep, there we go, seeing them coming up on our screens right now. So it's interesting to me that one of the top answers, in fact, the top answer, is reassuring our stakeholders regarding our business's ability to cope with the short-term economic shock. I think if I had been answering that, my assumption would have been it was around sterling volatility or perhaps debt financing. Rick, has that come as a surprise to you?
No, not at all, actually. Yeah. And in my trivia, you'll hear in a minute. Whilst I do say, you know, dealing with some of the immediate actions around mitigating financial risk to be there, one key element is absolutely to communicate to your people, investors, and markets. So I've got that as a key priority right now.
Excellent. It's glad to see that you know more than I do about these matters. Would you like to move on with your presentation?
Okay, thank you, Sally. As Ian has indicated, and you know, Mark Carney predicted as well this morning, we will go through a period of significant uncertainty, which will need to be navigated. And what is certain is that there will be some significant changes which are going to impact most businesses. If you've already taken steps, as I've mentioned, to prepare, now is the time to broaden and deepen the understanding of what this result will mean and how you will respond to maximise the opportunities and minimise risks. If you've done less to prepare, now is the time to get started. And I think the first thing, if you haven't already, the first thing to do is to establish a task force and do that very quickly. Once this is in place, I've outlined here on this slide that you see three steps to navigate through the uncertainties ahead, to keep your business on track and to maximise the opportunities. The first step is to better understand the possible scenarios and the impacts, and by that I mean exploring the opportunities as well as the risks. We recommend setting up an environment where the right people are able to fully consider the different scenarios and identify key priorities for you as a business, but also to consider how you can influence the debate as well, either as a business or collectively. I term this environment a Brexit lab. We do anticipate a period of quite intense lobbying, and I think it's important for you to be able to focus on the key priorities for you and to participate in that debate where it's appropriate. As I said, there will be a premium on clear, consistent and informed communications. And, you know, I think that is one of the major priorities and one of the outcomes that you need to focus on over the coming days and weeks. Given the uncertainties, the second step is to develop what I would term a flexible, adaptable contingency or response plan. And then the third stage will be to monitor events and then take actions accordingly, which would include how you might influence the outcomes. Can we go to the next slide, please? I thought it would be helpful just to expand a little more on the Brexit Lab, and I've summarised here some of the learnings from our own experience of preparing for the outcome of the referendum, and in terms of working with clients already on this. As I mentioned, setting up the task force is the first step, is a key thing to do right now. And that means bringing the right people together from across your organisation, from business and from functions. And then also with the right external support, where additional knowledge, expertise, additional resources or perspectives are considered to be helpful. Doing this right from the outset is vital. Here in Deloitte, we brought over 40 of our industry leaders and functional specialists together to consider the implications and likely priorities for our clients and ourselves. Some months ago, and that had a huge benefit in accelerating our thinking around this process. Secondly, I think when dealing with complex uncertainties, well-designed but simple scenarios can help cut through the fog. They genuinely help focus the mind, and using scenarios that look at both near-term and longer-term effects also can help you break the issue down and ensure both strategic and tactical responses are developed, and where necessary, more immediate actions are given priority. Again, cognizant of the risks, but focused on the opportunities to grow and take advantage of the changing status of the UK. The third element that we found highly successful is the use of wargaming techniques. These will really help to accelerate thinking, develop more robust perspectives, and help build consensus across the organisation much more quickly. With the right people, and in our case our industry leaders and functional specialists here, we were able to build perspectives on a wide range of issues by industry very quickly, and we can obviously use these to give you a head start as well if necessary. It was also a highly effective way of using people's time. On to the next slide, please. So the outcome from the Brexit lab, as I've termed it, will enable you to focus on creating a strategic response plan. You will need to make strategic choices, and they need to be based on your key priorities and against the core scenarios that you use. You'll have to define key decision points and triggers for these so you know when you're likely to act. As I say, the plan needs to be flexible, it needs to be adaptable. It will include taking careful consideration of the markets you're operating in now, and in the future, supply chain considerations, as well as regulatory, talent, and tax and trade implications, amongst others. Next slide, please. On this slide, I've summarised the timeline over the next 2 years and beyond. The Prime Minister has already indicated that he may not invoke Article 50 immediately, but it is likely the pressure will mount and the Leave campaign may do whatever it can to accelerate the process. So, as I've said, you should start now to set up the right environment to enable detailed and considered planning. An indicative timeline would be to have a strategic response for a plan ready within the next 3 to 6 months, depending on where you're starting from. However, I do caution just to be prepared, because I expect markets, consumers, competitors, and suppliers will change behaviours earlier. So an agile response will be important to manage the situation, immediate risks, and maintain competitive positioning. We've set up our own war room to provide support to our clients and to guide you through the steps. And we can, of course, help you establish a task force and a management office, set up a Brexit lab environment with digital sharing platforms, scenario building capability, and wargaming techniques, as well as provide specific industry perspectives and subject matter expertise. So in summary, throughout the next few days and months, I'd say you should firstly make sure you're ready to communicate to your people and other stakeholders. Secondly, look carefully at how you can use this result to shape your business for the future and how you can influence the debate. And thirdly, consider using the approach and techniques I've mentioned to accelerate your thinking and help you navigate through these uncertainties. Okay, with that, I think I'm going to hand over to Christiane, who is in Brussels, for a view from Europe.
Thank you. I do understand this is very much uncharted territory. So I think people's first thought is there's so much uncertainty as to how this will play out. But I have to say I've been hearing a lot of shock, dismay and concern here in Europe. There will be a huge impact. You know, there's always the risk of a knock-on effect, and we've already heard this morning Marine Le Pen in France, Geert Wilders in the Netherlands, calling for referendums. To be seen if those referendums actually take place. But, you know, this will have a huge political impact on the EU, and I think will create a lot of political pressure on Germany and France, because for the Europe to continue, I think Germany and France really have to work together on this. And with the UK leaving, there's a risk that Germany may, to a certain extent, have to step into the UK's shoes for certain things. We saw the slide which talked about the balance of power, how decisions are taken, and what blocking minorities within the council would look like with and without the UK. I'd like to add that, you know, this will have a huge political impact on the very concept of the EU, its scope, the institutions, the way of working, and the balance of power. Personally, I don't think this is the beginning of the end of the EU. I think the core EU countries will anyway stay together. Their economies have been bound together for so long. They share so many borders. And also, I think it's a very different thing. It's seen as a peace project. This is what people learn in schools. It's a peace project. I think the UK has always had a slightly different take on this. But this is a rejection of the EU. And I think a lot of politicians will be gathering together and thinking about, you know, how can they focus the EU project more? How can they focus on results? And what can they bring to citizens? And as you mentioned, Ian, I really think there is a risk here that we might have a two-speed Europe and a, you know, narrowing of the scope. This is really a severe reality check for the EU. The UK influence, I think, will be very much missed. You know, the UK is known for being pragmatic, for being focused on business. And, you know, as I said, I think this will mean a bigger role for Germany. And, of course, for the European project to continue to succeed, there will be a need for Germany and France to work together very much. The question whether, you know, the negotiation process, as we've seen now with David Cameron's declaration, that it looks like the new Prime Minister, let's say, whether it's October or November, would give the formal notification. We would then enter into that two-year period, negotiation period. We'll have to see how those negotiations play out, whether they're factious or harmonious. I think it's a really good question. We'll have to see, really. I do think there'll be many member states will be keen to continue their good trading relationship with the UK. But I also think, to a certain extent, Europe will have an awful lot of things to deal with, an awful lot of things on its plate. And my sense is not that people will, you know, want to have a fractious or have a negative behaviour towards the UK. It will simply be that the UK will just be a little bit less of a priority. There'll be so many other things to fix. And a final point, hearing here the press is talking about, you know, big meetings in Brussels, so everyone will be gathering here in Brussels this weekend and more to hear. I think, as the comments I've heard to date, The one I noted most, I think, was from Donald Tusk, the president of the council, saying, what doesn't kill you makes you stronger. So let's see. So that's the update from Brussels for you.
Thank you very much, Chris-Jan. I'm going to finish off now with a short section looking at trade and tax. Now, trade is interesting because it's been more than 40 years since the UK has negotiated a trade agreement on its own behalf. That's because we have been part of the EU trading mechanism, the trading bloc, and there is a question, I think, to what extent the UK is capable of and has enough expertise to allow it to negotiate trade agreements either within the rest of the European Union or more widely. There are 53 trade agreements that the UK is party to by dint of the fact that it's currently a member of the EU. And the question is, how relevant are those to UK trade? I suspect the answer is extremely relevant. And how able is the UK to renegotiate those trade agreements on a two-year time frame? Now, as Ian has said, leaving the European Union is an entirely unprecedented thing. The closest we have to it is when Greenland left the EEC back in the 70s. It's worth remembering that Greenland at that time had a population size of Croydon today. So trying to compare the two economies is a real chalk and cheese exercise. The trade and tax and hence tariff implications, however, will depend on exactly what kind of model we end up with. Norway, Iceland and Liechtenstein are members of the European Economic Area, but not in the EU. That gives them access to the single market and therefore it obliges them to fulfil many of the key obligations of EU membership, including financial contributions, but does allow them to access the single market. Next level down is the so-called Switzerland model, which is a bilateral agreement. They typically offer limited access to the single market, which generally looks like some combination of tariff-free trade, specific access to the services market, and some guarantees that companies operating in those markets will be treated in a fair and non-discriminatory way. However, bilateral agreements rarely go so far as to establish a customs union or to address non-tariff barriers such as data protection. The next level down is the so-called Canada model. That brings even less access to the single market and doesn't give tariff-free access to all Canadian manufactured goods, nor does it give a number of key sectors access to the market. And indeed, it requires Canada to accept some EU rules when exporting to the EU, which we might expect the UK would similarly be obliged to undertake. And then there's the World Trade Organization membership level. That sets out rules governing trade between World Trade Organization members, which would include the UK. But doesn't give any preferential access to the single market. It certainly wouldn't create customs-free or tariff-free trade in the way that we currently enjoy. The customs union, it's worth noting though, does include countries like Turkey, Andorra, San Marino and Monaco, so there is some precedent, I think, for the possibility that the UK could at least negotiate some form of entry into the customs union. Next slide, please. So then, let's just look at the indirect tax measures for the moment. Indirect taxes would be far more affected by the fact that we would be leaving the EU because on the main, many of them are fully harmonious taxes. If we start with customs duty then, that's almost entirely governed by EU directives and regulations, and the rates are set at an EU level. Duty collected on imports in the UK is remitted directly to the Union. Following this exception, one would assume that it would be necessary for some form of domestic UK customs duty legislation to be put in place. I can't see that the UK would willingly forego that level of income. But then the question would be, can we enact domestic law that merely replicates the effect of the current EU provisions, or would we attempt something slightly different? Perhaps the biggest customs duty change relates to businesses that will see recognition of trade with EU companies now as import and export. And depending on the outcome of the secession negotiations, that could mean that duty becomes payable when goods move to and from EU member states. That and the related import and export formalities may or may not result in some impediments to trade. It will almost certainly involve an upgrade in IT systems to allow for the fact that instead of trading within a single block, there are now 27 different trading partners. Excise duty then is not currently fully harmonised across the EU. The main issue there is that, as with customs duty, movement of excise goods between the UK and EU member states would then become import and export. Subject to any agreements reached during negotiations, such movements are likely to be subject to different procedures than the current relatively straightforward intra-EU trading rules. VAT then, it's supposed to be a fully harmonised tax, currently governed by the VAT directives and regulations implemented into corresponding domestic legislation. I think it's fair to say that VAT could be materially affected by leaving the EU. Trade with EU member states would again no longer involve intra-EU dispatches and acquisitions with corresponding reporting obligations, but would become again exports and imports. The EU mini one-stop shop is going to need to switch off, and businesses seeking VAT refunds from EU member states will need to use the 13th directive refund process rather than the electronic intra-EU refund scheme. Now, of course, the courts of the European Union oftentimes are asked by the UK domestic courts to interpret UK provisions, probably more so in the world of indirect tax than anywhere else. They will now have to revert to interpreting the UK provisions and might have less regard to the decisions that have emerged from the CJEU over the past 20 or 30 years. The fact that the UK will no longer have to comply with EU VAT law, whether that's on rates or scopes of exemption or whatever, will mean that following leaving, the UK is going to have much more flexibility in those areas. Future governments might consider, for example, restoring zero rating for domestic fuel supply, or reinstating VAT relief for energy-saving products and similar. I don't think it's possible at this stage to forecast possible changes, but any future government will need to consider whether it wishes to make policy changes to stimulate and encourage certain forms of taxpayer behaviour. Next slide, please. Now, direct taxes, then, are solely a national competence as a matter of EU constitution. Direct taxes are not expressly dealt with by the EU treaty, but the four treaty freedoms, the freedom to provide services, the free movement of people, that particularly thorny one, free movement of capital and freedom of establishment are all relevant for direct tax. The CJEU, the Court of Justice of the EU, adjudicates whether national law infringes any of the treaty freedoms. The UK domestic tax law has, in a couple of instances, been found to so infringe, and we have then been obliged to update our domestic law provisions. Are we likely, in the course of the negotiation period, to have changing UK tax law high up on the list of priorities? My gut feeling is the answer is no. What else might change? Well, the directives would no longer have direct application. That's not such a big deal, because most of them have already been transposed into UK domestic law. I think the bigger issue would be that many jurisdictions, including the UK, have reliefs available to EU member states that are not available more widely. And oftentimes, that legislation is drafted in terms of, and I'm clearly paraphrasing here, but drafted in terms of, if you're interacting with an EU member state, then we'll give you the relief, and if you're not interacting with an EU member state, then we won't. If the Netherlands, for example, with its holding company regime, doesn't have to make any changes to its domestic legislation whatsoever to deny the EU access to those reliefs, simply because the UK would no longer be a member of the EU. So plenty to think about. Moving on to the next slide then. My critical message, however, from a tax perspective, is that it's not going to be the make or break matter for leave for businesses. There are things that we should think about if we're in the world of tax, or that business people will want to talk to their tax colleagues about. But it is the commercial issues which will make or break companies, whether it's stakeholder engagement or whether it's interest and access to finance or currency exposure. Those are the things that are going to make or break companies, not the tax matters in particular. In the short term, a vote in favour of leaving the EU will have little, if any, immediate impact on indirect or direct taxes, because it's all in the domestic legislation already. And although we could see some divergence of the UK's position from the EU norms over a period of time, I don't think that any of those are necessarily going to be too much of an issue for companies, because they will be flagged well in advance. It's really, really important that commercial people and tax people, however, keep talking, because there are any number of bear pits which tax people can help you avoid, but which you might otherwise stumble into inadvertently when you are making your commercial decisions. So I think the really critical point there is keep talking to all of your colleagues to make sure you have a fully joined up response. And that brings us to the end of our formal presentation. We do now have some time for questions and answers. So Ian.
Yeah, so we've got a question here about the effect on the property market and mortgages of what's happened. And I think this kind of illustrates a wider effect, because I think there's going to be a pool. Clearly, we're going to be in a world of very cheap money for a very long time to come. So the way that the market has reacted to this shock is by assuming that interest rates will remain even lower for even longer. And clearly, there is a possibility that the Bank of England will go further and undertake additional quantitative easing. So in a cheap money world, of course, residential property is illiquid, and perhaps surprisingly, to some extent, it became a bit of a safe haven in the immediate aftermath of the financial crisis. We were looking back at what asset you should have invested in since 2007, and it turns out that residential property has performed well relative to other assets. That's not a recommendation. I mean, clearly, property suffers from uncertainty and from weak growth, and you would expect the sell-off in liquid assets to some extent to be transferred to less liquid assets. But I think what you are likely to see, certainly in the short term, and we did see this in 2008-09 in a very big way, is a big decline in turnover, particularly in the residential housing market. So you saw a kind of freezing up of transactions as the shock manifested in terms of there for us. Just one other question, which actually has been on the economic side, which has been asked by a number of people, about how feasible is it to do a trade deal as Lee hopes by the end of this parliament. That seems rather ambitious. Well, the trade deals that the EU has struck with other countries in recent years are generally taken between 4 to 9 years. Now, the Leave camp would say it's different this time around, because there is already no tariff trade between the UK and the EU, and there is regulatory equivalence. Our regulations are the same as Europe's. And that, those things, they argue, will make it quicker. So the short answer is we've got no idea at all.
Okay, it's Ricky. We've had a few questions, actually, around what is wargaming. And so just to put a spin on that, it's actually based on techniques developed by the military to develop strategy and planning, so hence the term wargaming. But essentially, it enables you to look at different scenarios, really examine your priorities and responses to those, but with appropriate challenges on external factors. It may be a competitor does something, or there's a sudden change of tack in the negotiations. And the concept is it's highly interactive, so it really helps people think things through and live it, rather than just planning in a sort of fairly dry way or running, you know, fairly standard type of workshops. It's much more interactive than just a normal workshop. We typically use as well digital sharing platforms such as Think Tank, so that helps capture and share the outcomes as we progress through the war game. But essentially, as I've said, we find it really does accelerate the thinking. It makes sure the planning is more robust, and it certainly helps build consensus as well amongst everybody who's going to be involved in it.
A couple of tax questions. My favourite one, which the asker did say was tongue-in-cheek, is it RIP for VAT? So with my tongue firmly in my cheek, the answer is not on your nelly. It's far too big a tax for any government to wish to withdraw from. In the UK, it's worth about £150 billion sterling per year. So the honest answer is, not only is it a really significant tax in terms of quantum, but it also is very much the international norm. And indeed, a number of jurisdictions are choosing to introduce VAT or GST that didn't otherwise have it before. So my expectation is that it is not at all RIP for VAT, but we may see some convergence. And another tax question then, what's the expected impact on BEPS Action 4? Now, for those of you not in tax, BEPS is the OECD G20 International Tax Reform Project, and Action 4 specifically looks at limiting interest deductions to broadly 30% of tax EBITDA. My expectation is that BEPS Action 4 implementations won't be changed. There are six European jurisdictions that already believe themselves to be BEPS Action 4 compliant, basically Germany, Spain, Italy, France, and a couple of other jurisdictions. The UK has committed to implementing the interest limitation proposal of BEPS by the 1st of April 2017. I do appreciate that it is a huge number of, for most companies, of tax that's going to be collected, an estimate of around £1 billion a year sterling from the UK Exchequer. But the BEPS project is not an EU project, it's an OECD project, and we absolutely expect that all of its measures will be introduced in the UK. What time frame will that be over? I still think it will be by 1 April 2017. I suspect, however, that the legislative process may be slowed down somewhat. We just have time probably for one more question. I'm handing over to Ian.
Yeah, this is actually a very good question. What is the impact on euro area growth? I've said that the consensus of economists is that there will be a sharp slowdown in UK growth. Now, this is before the actual event. So this survey was done a couple of weeks ago. The UK growth next year will be about 0.7%, so quite a sharp slowdown. What about Europe? Well, the consensus of economists at the moment is that growth next year will slow from a previous 1.7% to 1.4%. So the expectation is that the UK suffers a lot more damage in terms of growth than the euro area. There's a relatively modest slowdown in euro area growth. What we do know from looking at the trade linkages is that some countries like the Netherlands and Ireland, the Scandinavian countries, are much more effective. They're much closer to the UK, so are liable to be more affected. Remember, these are only forecasts, and as we saw yesterday, forecasts are often wrong. With that, I'm handing over to Mark.
Ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much indeed for joining us today. I think we've had about 10,000 people on the call, and thank you very much for your questions. I hope you've got something very valuable out of it. We clearly enter a new chapter of uncertainty and volatility, and as a number of you said in your polls, this is the time for extensive communication and discussions with stakeholders, with employees, and generally with the market as a whole. The slides will continue to be available, and you'll be able to download the recorded version of this webcast at the URL that's there up on the screen in front of you. Thank you very much indeed, and we look forward to supporting you in any way we can over the coming weeks and months. Thank you very much, and have a wonderful day.